You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with newly appointed Sri Lankan President Gotabaya Rajapaksa's maiden state visit to India. The visit that was aimed at further deepening the strategic and trade ties between two countries turned out to be fructiferous as both New Delhi and Colombo decided to work together in multiple spheres.
Setting his priorities straight right at the beginning of his term, President Gotabaya Rajapaksa made his maiden visit to its closest neighbour, India, in just over 10 days after assuming office. His intentions of further enhancing the bilateral ties between the countries were adequately reciprocated as India rolled out red carpet for him at the presidential palace. He discussed a range of relations between New Delhi and Colombo with Indian Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar. He committed to mend his outlook towards Tamil community in Sri Lanka and assured better opportunity for them in coming times.
My expectations are very high and I want to, during my tenure as the president, I want to bring the relationship between India and Sri Lanka into a very high level, and at the same time we need to work together for the benefit of India as well as Sri Lanka and people of Sri Lanka, and on security as well as the economic development.
Gotabaya discussed a host of ties with Prime Minister Narendra Modi. He discussed the situation in the Indian Ocean region and steps to boost trade and investment ties. Appreciating Gotabaya's decision of picking India as his first foreign destination, Modi said that New Delhi will continue to work with Colombo for a prosperous future of two countries and the region.
Dono deshon ki pragati aur hamare is pure saajha kshetra mein shanti, samruddhi aur suraksha ke liye हम राष्ट्रपति राजपक्ष के साथ घनिष्ठ रूप से काम करने के लिए तत्पर हैं।
श्रीलंका has long been a priority destination for direct investment from India. While Sri Lanka is one of India's largest trading partners among the SAARC countries, India in turn is Sri Lanka's largest trade partner globally. Trade between the two countries grew particularly rapidly after the India-Sri Lanka Free Trade Agreement, which came into force in March 2000. India and Sri Lanka have had extraordinary ties for decades, but they received minor hiccups when the leadership got close to Beijing. However, Gotabaya, ever since he was a presidential candidate, has said that he will improve ties with India.
Well, to speak more on this, we are now joined in by Professor Anto, who is Director Academics of the Defence Academy in Coimbatore. So, Mr. Anto, how do you see President Gotabaya's visit to India? How important, according to you, are India and Sri Lanka for each other in these constantly evolving geopolitical dynamics?
Visit to India by Mr. Gotabaya Rajapakse, the President of Sri Lanka, newly elected President of Sri Lanka, is actually a good sign in many ways. One, the Modi government is very keen to establish contact with a new government, a new face, a person who is not a new face, actually is an old face. He was part of the 2009 war victory over the LTT. He was a main face. He was a main factor, the person who actually led the military, the Sri Lankan military, over its victory over Sri Lanka, the LTT armed forces in 2009. Now Gotabaya has come as a president, and a very powerful president, has won with a majority landslide victory. Now the agenda of the Indian government, from Indian side, the Modi government, will be three things. First, economic cooperation with Sri Lanka. Number two, the relationship with China. And number three, the repatriation of the Tamils in the northern and eastern provinces. Let's take it one by one. Number one, the economic trade pact with India. We've got a good trade with Sri Lanka, but it has to get better. And our worry now is China is going to barge in. China already has got a large economic and financial interest in Sri Lanka. The Hambantota port has been taken over by China, and it is very dangerous. And the repatriation of the Tamils, getting good jobs, settling down, is very important.
Both India and Sri Lanka have been the victims of terrorism. Do you think both can support each other in fighting the menace of it?
Yes, terrorism will play a major role. Both countries have to cooperate and counter the threat of terrorism in commonality to two countries.
Moving on, U.S. President Donald Trump made a surprise Thanksgiving visit to U.S. troops in Afghanistan. In his second ever visit to a war zone, Trump said that peace talks with the Taliban have resumed. Trump also discussed the deal prospects with Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, who later informed that a ceasefire and the dismantling of terror camps on Afghan soil were two major and common demands of Kabul and Washington. A report.
Presidential plane Air Force One touched down at the Bagram Air Base as US President Donald Trump made his first and surprise visit to Afghanistan. The visit that came just a week after the successful prisoner swap between the Taliban and Kabul was seemingly aimed at securing the opportunity of once again negotiating with the Taliban. While appreciating the efforts of the US forces, Trump said that Taliban wanted to make a deal with them.
The Taliban wants to make a deal. We'll see if they want to make a deal. It's got to be a real deal, but we'll see. But they want to make a deal. And they only want to make a deal because you're doing a great job. That's the only reason they want to make a deal.
Taliban had earlier confirmed to several media houses that talks that had suffered an abrupt end in September this year have resumed on informal level in Qatar. Since his days as presidential candidate, Trump has wanted to end U.S. involvement in Afghanistan and on several occasions expressed his urge of calling his troops back. He reassured the soldiers that he would call them back and the technology will take care of the enemy at the ground.
Weeks ago, we also announced that the forces are coming back. They're coming back home. We're reducing over here, but because of technology and all of the things that we have, we're able to reduce in Afghanistan, very substantially actually reduce, and do even more devastating attacks on the enemy. So that's part of the $2.5 trillion that we have coming.
Even after 18 years of protracted war, 13,000 U.S. forces are still present in Afghanistan. 2,400 have been killed in the course of the conflict. A draft accord agreed in September would have seen thousands of them returning in exchange for guarantees that Afghanistan would not be used as a base for militant attacks on the United States or its allies. However, things did not materialize. The hostility between the two sides worsened, which resulted in more destruction and more casualties.
And since then, we've hit them so hard, they've never been hit this hard. In the history of the war, they have never been hit this hard. And they want to make a deal. So we'll see what happens. If they make it, fine. If they don't make it, that's fine. We're going to be able to do everything we're doing and actually more. And at the same time, we're bringing down the number of troops substantially. But we're able to, because of the weaponry and all of the things that we have in place, we can do actually more damage with even fewer troops. So we're bringing it down very substantially, and we'll be down at a number that's a good number. And we're going to stay until such time as we have a deal or we have total victory. And they want to make a deal very badly. So we're dealing with, this is really for the media, I guess, more than anybody, because the president knows what I'm saying. The Taliban wants to make a deal, and we're meeting with them, and we're saying it has to be a ceasefire. They didn't want to do a ceasefire, but now they do want to do a ceasefire, I believe. It probably work out that way. And we'll see what happens. But we've made tremendous progress.
Trump also held bilateral talks with Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, in which he discussed the key bargaining issues of ceasefire and the use of Afghan territory to launch militant attacks on the United States. Ghani, who has been rebuffed by the Taliban, disclosed the nuances of the meeting on social media. While Trump has not provided a specific number of troops leaving Afghanistan in the coming future, US military has said before that 8,600 troops are enough to carry out essential counter-terrorism operations in the country. In spite of the president being optimistic, many US officials still doubt the Taliban could be relied upon to prevent Al-Qaeda from again plotting attacks against the United States from the Afghan soil.
Moving on, Supreme Court of Pakistan has struck down Imran Khan government's decision of giving a three-year extension to the Army Chief Qamar Javed Bajwa. The court, which has given a six-month temporary extension to the general, has also said that the government must pass legislation through Parliament in that time to clarify the section of Pakistan's constitution governing the armed forces.
In a major setback to Pakistan Army and its generals, who hold great sway in country's discourse, the apex court has deemed three-year extension to Qamar Javed Bajwa invalid. While the court has granted a relief to general by granting him a six-month extension, it has also asked the government to defend its decision, which it said was loaded with irregularities. The Supreme Court said that it would be liberal in handling the case, which it could have handled sternly. The court has also asked the government to make necessary amendments in the Army Act and come up with legislation in order to make appointments democratic and legal.
Today, Supreme Court of Pakistan took up the case pertaining to the appointment of the Pakistan Army Chief, which is one of the most important and most sensitive appointment in Pakistan, and they have concluded in a manner that the Parliament has been directed to enact law to regulate the terms and conditions of the services of Pakistan Army Chief, and also he has been given extension for 6 months under the ongoing practice under the army laws. And meanwhile, Parliament has been directed to enact legislation to regulate the...
Prime Minister Imran Khan, who has widely been criticized for playing stooge to the army headquarters in Rawalpindi, hailed the verdict, saying it was the defeat of those who were expecting Pakistan to be destabilized by the clash of institutions. However, the gesture is confusing as the decision was pronounced against his own government. It is his administration which wants to see Bajwa as top army commander. The army chief usually serves a three-year term. Since the role was established in 1972, only one general has had its term extended by a civilian government. Government backs Bajwa, citing his efficiency at handling military crisis and expertise in Kashmir region. But during his tenure, the military has been accused by opposition politicians of electoral manipulation, meddling in politics, suspension of civil liberties, and muzzling the media to help Khan win power last year. People across various sections of the society have expressed the violence unleashed under the commands of Bajwa. They say that their lands and resources have been snatched on instructions of the army general.
ये पौजी जिधर भी जो पहाड़ में सोना उड़ते उधर ये आते कब्जा करते 10 दिनों में तालिब पैदा हो जाएगा टारगेट हो जाएगा फिर तो लोग मजबूर करते हैं वो जबरदस्ती से निकालते ये नहीं कहा आराम जबरदस्ती से निकालते और हजार बार उन्होंने असिफ गफूर ने कहा बजवा ने भी कहा कि हमने ऑपरेशन किया कहा मैं भी ऑपरेशन था रास्ता यानी जो कबली रहे तो क्लियर हो गया तो आज क्यों उन लोग उधर मरते हैं
पाकिस्तान्स पावरफुल मिलिट्री हैज रूल्ड द कंट्री फॉर मोर देन हाफ ऑफ इट्स 72 ईयर हिस्ट्री and sets defense and security policy. Although the decision has provided some kind of reprieve to the government, the episode could weaken the authority of the coalition government led by Khan's Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf party that now has to pass what is likely to be complex legislation on the military through parliament.
Moving on, a gun-wielding Islamabad has exploited the illegally occupied territories of Gilgit-Baltistan and POK for more than 7 decades. Intimidation and immoral legislations have been Pakistan's primary tools in its endeavors of subjugating the locals. When it comes to freedom of expression, even a hint of dissent is crushed with severe high-handedness. However, the locals are mounting a strong resistance against the establishment, and it has escalated notches since Pakistan unleashed violence on peaceful demonstrators on 22nd October. A report.
The illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan and POK have been hit by sweeping protests against Pakistani misrule in these territories. The protests, which sparked in the wake of the state agency's high-handedness on peaceful demonstration on 22nd of October, have gathered huge traction amongst the masses and have transformed into one of the biggest dissents popping up from the region. While an anti-establishment anger was always prevalent in the region, the emotion is unprecedented this time, and people say they will not withdraw unless their demands are met. Even the exiled activists of the region have lent their support, calling for independence.
October 22 को इस साल जब People's National Alliance, जो कि 26 parties और groups और individuals का एक alliance है, democratic alliance है, जब उन्होंने call दी मुजफ्फराबाद में कि हम मुजफ्फराबाद जाएंगे और वहाँ पे अपने मुतालबात रखेंगे, तो within hours उनके ऊपर इतना शदीद लाठी चार्ज किया, और उसकी वीडियोस मौजूद है जिसमें आप देख सकते हैं कि बायस्टैंडर्स को पुलिस वालों ने पीछे से लाठियां मार के उनको बेहोश किया। 4 लोग वहां पे शहीद हुए, 150 से ज़्यादा लोगों को गिरफ्तार किया, 100 से ज़्यादा लोगों को डिसअपीयर किया वहां से, और उन्होंने फिर जब प्रेस क्लब में उनकी क़ियादत जो थी उसने जाके वहाँ पर अपनी जान बचाने की कोशिश की, तो पुलिस ने प्रेस क्लब पर हमला कर दिया।
People in Gilgit-Baltistan and POK are deprived of the fundamental rights. They do not have access to basic amenities, and their land and resources have been snatched through illegal exercises of Pakistan. Many of them have been forced to leave their ancestral homes after establishment marked it for state use. Prime Minister of Pakistan, who was widely criticized in his own country for playing second fiddle to army generals when it comes to framing and executing policies, is a self-proclaimed protector and supporter of these people. However, the locals have rejected his claim, saying the situation has further worsened under his bid at ruling the region.
पाकिस्तानी ऑक्यूपाइड कश्मीर और गिलगित बल्तिस्तान में मुझे ये बताएं कि कितना इंसाफ दिया है इमरान खान ने, या आज तक की किसी भी पाकिस्तानी गवर्नमेंट ने। हमारे इस वक्त जो दोस्त हैं वो गिलगित की जेलों में, गाकोट जेलों में 70-70 साल की उनको सजाएं दी हैं सिर्फ एनवायरनमेंट बेस्ड कैंपेन्स चलाने पर। जो चाइना जो माइंस हमारी ख़रीदना चाहता था उसके ख़िलाफ़ जो प्रोटेस्ट हुए हैं लोकल आबादी के, उनको अरेस्ट करके उन्होंने जेलों में डाला है, और उनको 40-40 साल, 70-70 साल, और एक को 90 साल की सजा दी है।
The growing resentment in the region has set the alarm bells ringing for Pakistan, as it might transform into a full-fledged rebellion if Pakistan, which is deemed occupier by the locals, does not give in to people's demands. the demands are nothing but vacating the territory that Islamabad has occupied for 72 long years.
India recently hosted 39th edition of India International Trade Fair 2019, the one of the largest trade fairs in the world, both in terms of exhibitors and visitors. Over 800 firms from across India and overseas participated in this mammoth event, making it a unique display altogether. Let's take a look.
Ritzy pavilions, excited visitors, and a unique variety of items from across the world. This is what defined the beauty of India International Trade Fair 2019. The mega event, organized by India Trade Promotion Organization, saw a participation of around 3,000 exhibitors from almost 19 countries. The overwhelming participation from abroad is an indication of the strengthening of foreign relations and the growing integration of India with the global economy. Ranging from the beautiful gems and bracelets from Iran to the traditional carpets of Afghanistan, the international pavilion had much more to attract the visitors.
I am representing the Afghan carpets here in IATPO 2019. And we are getting a very good response from the Indian crowd, and then hopefully we are looking forward to, you know, bring more exclusive Afghan carpets to the Indian market. What I'm carrying here right now is flatted weaving and this pile weaving. Flatted weaving is called as kilim. So you can see this is a kilim, and it is called as flatted weaving, and it comes from the northern province of Afghanistan, Herat, and then people are liking too much here.
The theme for the 2019 edition of the fair was ease of doing business. The theme was also put forward to all the Indian states and union territories that showcased their products during the fair. This year, the status of partner country has been accorded to the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan and the Republic of Korea as a focus country. Visitors were seen enjoying various attractions and purchasing handicraft items and other products.
I come to know about this stall. This is really very good, and prices are very reasonable, and stuff is very good. People are very cooperative over here, and we are buying this stuff, and we are thankful to these people. Those they are giving us great sarees.
We are visiting Pragati Maidan. It's a very beautiful place, and the Afghani stalls here are very good, and the products which they are selling, that is exquisite. And I'm astonished by seeing all the dry fruits over here.
Traders from Australia, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Afghanistan, Nepal, Thailand, Turkey and Vietnam displayed their products at the fair. The India International Trade Fair provides a reliable and tested platform to small and medium enterprises, exporters, entrepreneurs and investors. It is the largest integrated trade fair with business-to-business and business-to-consumer components.
The number of people thronging the trade fair is increasing every year. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching Tag TV.